Welcome to the 14th video of the Blender 2.8 Beginners Tutorial Series. In this video, we will take a closer look at the EEVEE render engine, which we basically used all the time till this point. But here we want to take a look at all the settings we have, some nice effects we can enable like this bloom glow effect or depth of field, and then we will learn how to export a final image. As always, you can find the timestamps in the video description below. And if you want to follow along, you can sign up to our resource section free of charge, where you can download all the project files, textures and videos for this tutorial series and our handy Blender 2.8 shortcut PDF. Hi everyone, Zach here for cgboost.com and let's get started. So I'm in the camera view in the layout workspace and I disabled all the viewport gizmos and the viewport overlays so we just see the final result here. And for setting up the lighting and materials and everything, we used the EEVEE real-time render engine. So first of all, I noticed that I accidentally left this area lamp in the scene. Let's select this and let's delete this. Then the first thing I want to do, let's go to the scene, select the camera. Let's quickly enable the overlays. Here we have the camera. Go to the camera settings and in the viewport display, enable limits. Why? I show you in a second. Let's enable depth of field. And now if I reduce the focus, we can see this yellow cross over there. And with this yellow cross, we define the focus because depth of field basically adds a blurry back and foreground, and we can only see this area near the cross as in focus. So let's take a look from the camera perspective. And if I change the distance over here, you can see it pretty clearly. Let's move it closer towards the knife because this area is our main focus. And then we can play around with the f-stop. So if I reduce this, you can see the effect is really strong. Let's disable the viewport overlays. But then we can't see anything from the nice scene anymore. So I wouldn't make this too strong. So I think the default value of 2.8 fits very nicely. And now let's go over to the EEVEE render settings. First of all, we have the samples over here. Sometimes we have a value for render and for viewport. Viewport is basically the value we see here live when we navigate our view. And the render is when we output our final image. So some of the effects like the glossiness here or this contact shadow is using the sampling, which you can see by this noise. And when you move your camera around and leave it still, then you can see that this effect needs a little while until you have the full quality. And if I set this to 64, you can see that this will be the final quality in the final rendering. But for the viewport, since we want to have a fluent running viewport, we don't need that high values. Let's go over to Ambient Occlusion. Let's enable this. And here you can't see a big difference, but when I switch over to the look dev mode, you can see it quite clearly. If I disable this, this adds this nice contact shadow when objects are very close to each other. Then we have this shadow. We can also increase the distance if we like. And this adds a lot of realism, as you can see here, because now it looks as if the light doesn't shine into these gaps over here. And this works also in the rendered viewport shading, but since we have a lot of hard and dark shadows, we can't see it that clearly. Anyway, we leave this enabled. Then let's enable the bloom effect, which adds this nice glow, but certainly we don't want to have this effect to be so strong. So let's open up the settings here and increase the threshold. That means only the very bright areas have this little glow effect. You can also change the radius here if you like and some other settings. And then let's also change the intensity a bit. And this is what you need to know about this right now. Then I also enabled screen space reflections while we were working on the materials. This is disabled by default. And as you can see, if this is disabled, we don't have this nice refraction effect here in the water drops. And we don't have the reflection of the objects here on the surface of the objects. So if I enable this again, you can see we have the nice refraction effect since this is enabled here as well. And we also have the nice reflections in the objects. To have a better reflection now for the rendering process, we can disable half res trace to have a higher resolution in the reflections. The screen space reflection, if you enable it here, it will work for all the objects, but the refraction will only work if you select an object, go to the material settings, settings, and enable screen space refraction. This we already did for the drops. If I select one drop here, you can see this is enabled. Otherwise, this won't work. Then let's take a look at the shadow settings over here. Let's change the method to VSM, which has a little bit better quality. And then let's change the cube size here to 1024 pixels, which adds a better quality to the shadow. And to avoid some shadow errors here and there, you can also click on this high bit depth. And if you want to have a little bit more realistic shadows in your final image, you can enable soft shadows. You can see if I move around, this is flickering, but as soon as the camera is still, it's calculating the effect. And it's basically randomizing the rotation of the shadow a bit and blending this together, and then it looks like we have realistic soft shadow. Here you can see the result with and here without. So here we have much harder shadows and soft shadow makes it realistic. So for the final EEVEE rendering, I leave this soft shadow enabled. Then let's take a look under film. If we want to render the background here, which don't have any objects, as transparent later on, we have to enable transparent over here. And here's also a nice little feature which can be quite important. For example, if I zoom in here, you can see at some point here on the edge, the shadow disappears, which is basically outside of the frame. And to avoid this for the final render, we can enable the overscan, and then this will add 3% of our final image to the frame around the image to have the shadow calculated outside of the image, so we see it here correctly inside of the image. So if you do an EEVEE render, I really recommend to enable this overscan. So, and the last thing I want to do here under color management, look, I set the look to medium high contrast. By default, this is set to none. You can see this looks a little bit more flat, and with the look, we can increase the contrast. But I don't want to have this too high, so let's use medium high contrast, which I like. And this adds this contrast also to the real-time view here. And then we have stronger colors here in the image. So one last final tweak here, you can see that the shadow on this area looks a bit off, and that's because, let's select one of the area lamps, we have enabled the contact shadow. If I disable this, you can see this disappears because the contact shadow is not super realistic in terms of the depth. But I think for this specific lamp here, for the white lamp, it's not really adding much to the scene. It's basically destroying the scene a bit because it adds this weird shadow. So in this case, I disable the contact shadow and then the whole thing looks way better, I think. So now we have set up all the render settings. Now let's go quickly over to the output settings here. So here we can change the resolution of our final image. It's a standard HD resolution right now. So and here I want to have a really high quality, so I increase the percentage to 200%. So this basically doubles the resolution we have up here. And down here we can also change the output settings, but here we just need to change it if we want to output an animation. If we want to output a still image, we can also change it later on while saving the image. So that means we don't need to set up anything here. And now in order to render this image so that we generate our final image, we click on render and render image or press F12. Before I do that, I change the display mode to image editor, because otherwise Blender will open a new window where the rendering shows up. But here I want to have this showing up in the same window, so I changed the display mode to image. So before we render the image, there are three small things we have to change. First of all, the blade of the knife just appears in one color. So what I would do, I select the handle. We can enable the viewport overlays, press R, X twice for the rotation, and rotate this just a bit so that we can see the structure here. And what I just realized when I zoom in here is that the knife is a bit out of focus. That means the focus of our camera is not exactly there where we want it. So let's select the camera once again, go to the camera settings and change the distance. And you can see that we now have the focus on the knife, but to make sure that's really the case, take a look from the side, enable the viewport overlays, and then you can see this yellow cross is now exactly here. That means this area will be in focus. So, and another small thing which I didn't mention earlier, let's enable the drops once again. Let's select all of them and move them to the side here. As you remember, we disabled the collection over here. That means they won't show up in the viewport. However, if I do a quick render, click on render, render image, you can see that they will show up. So the question is, how can we hide them for the rendering process? Let's hit Escape to get back to the 3D view. And what we need to do first, up here, click on this filter icon and enable this camera icon. These are the restriction toggles for the rendering, because the eye only hides objects in the 3D viewport. So I can hide the drops for the rendering. The problem is, if I render this image, you can see they are gone. However, they are also gone on the apples. And certainly we want to have them on the apples, but not over here. Let's hit Escape, and that's why we have to use a small trick. Let's open up the drops collection, then select the collection and add a new one. You can see that a sub-collection was added, and all we need to do now is to select all the drops here and move them into the sub-collection. The sub-collection is visible for rendering, but the parent collection up here is not visible for rendering. Now, let's select an apple, go to the particle system, and under render, change the instance collection to drops 1. And let's also do the same thing for the cut apple. You can see now both of them have also the drops 1 collection. And that means if I now click up here, render image, or hit F12, you can see now it's exactly how we want it. The drops are gone over here, but they still show up on the apples. The knife down here is now also in focus, and now we can save this image. As you can see, this took roughly 13 seconds to render. This is not real time, but you have to keep in mind we generated the image with a very high resolution, and all the effects, the shadows and so on, also needs to be calculated with the full 64 samples, and this still takes a little while. So the final rendering process is not real time, but compared to cycles, as you will see later on, still super fast. So in order to save this image, that you can use it further in any photo editor or post it on social media, click on Image, Save As, or hit Shift S. Then up here you can choose your hard drive. Over here you can navigate through your folders, and with this button you can also create new folders. I created this render folder. Let's call this Apple Scene 01, because we maybe want to create more of these renders later on. And then down here we can change the image format. Right now you can see PNG is enabled. I would recommend to leave PNG enabled, because it is a lossless format. That means when you save this image you won't lose any quality, but you can also go with JPEG or any other image format. Then the color we can set to RGB, that we only have the color red, green and blue. If you want to export this with a transparent alpha channel, you have to choose RGBA, and you have to check the transparent option in the render settings under film, which I showed you earlier. Then if you want to have the highest possible quality, change the color depths to 16-bit. This is important if you want to post-process the image. That means change the color, contrast and all this stuff later on in an external image editor. If this is not the case, then 8-bit is totally fine. So if you want to post it straight to social media or something like that. So in my case, I want to have full quality, and then simply hit Save as Image. So to go back to the 3D viewport, simply hit Escape, and don't forget to save the blend file. And now, as you can see here, you can open this on your hard drive and do whatever you want to do with this image. And since we rendered this in a quite high resolution, if I zoom in here, you can see we have a lot of details. Yeah guys, now you know how to use the EEVEE render engine with all the different settings we can set up, with all the nice effects we can set up, and you know how to export a final image. If you enjoyed this video, make sure to give it a like, subscribe to this channel and ring the bell underneath this video if you want to get notified for future videos. And if you enjoyed this video, you might also enjoy our Blender 2.8 Launchpad course, where we will also make extensive use of EEVEE, and there we will not only create a static image, there we will create a fully animated 3D scene from scratch. Click on the link in the video description below if you want to learn more, and also check the free preview lessons on the product page. Thanks a lot for watching guys, now check the next and final video of this tutorial series, where we will take a closer look at the more photorealistic Cycles render engine. There we will take a look at some important settings, we will adjust some things in our scene to work better with this Cycles render engine, for example the water drops, and then we will render out an image using this render engine, and we will use some denoising features to remove the noise from this noisy Cycles render. So don't miss this last video. I will see you there. Goodbye.